have that difficulty of knowing what we've planned for is really what God would have us to speak. And the amazing thing was, as I put it together, I didn't have a theme. And I kind of give one to Larry for the video. But Larry, the other Larry, came in, and I didn't see him. I was really looking for him. I said, were you late? I didn't see you. He says, I was right on time. And I says, that's what I should have named my message. Now, he's right on time. And that's important because Jesus Christ was right on time every time. He never one time showed up early, nor did he show up late. He was always right at the right moment. And whether you believe it or not, that is the message that I have for you tonight. We're all sons of God. 1 John 3:2. Now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. We'll be likened unto him because we too are a child of God. When we first started this message, it was a couple pages. Went to 3 pages. I redid it over some time ago now. It now got 4 pages, and today it went to 5. So I'm not going to talk about it all. Somewhere I'm going to have to do some cutting. But I do want to tell you, sometimes when you get started in the scriptures, one thing leads to the other, and then the next, then the next. And somehow you see them all tied together. And it's so amazing because when you get up, Sue said, you've been studying for a week. Don't get too windy. it's so exciting to me to see these things. I want to share them with you. Some of them are really kind of really neat. Two scriptures that are ones in the Old Testament, ones in the New. John 4:24. It says, God, you don't need to turn because I'm going to just a short passage and I'm going to go to something else. John says, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit. That's a small spirit. That's talking about with the spirit of man and truth. No true worship unless it is through the sincere heart of the individual and in truth. False teaching does not honor God. It is not worship. No matter how sincere. And that's where the word comes to me from the book of Joshua 24:14, which is really saying the same things with a slight change in meaning. It says, Now therefore, hear the word of the Lord and worship him in sincerity and truth. It means exactly the same thing. Sincerity means with the heart. And it means to be sincere. You can't worship God without being sincere. Impossible. And you cannot worship God except you be in truth. There are many things that are expressed in the scriptures. We're going to go to Zacchaeus, and I want you to look at Luke, the 19th chapter, in the first verse. Zacchaeus was a tax collector underneath the Roman Senate. Rome really ruled Israel at this time, and he worked for the enemy. He worked for Rome. They were under captivity to them. Nobody liked Rome. So therefore, nobody loved Zacchaeus. He was very rich. He was a chief of the publicans, a tax collector. Now let's look at the passage of Scripture. And Jesus entered and passed through Jericho, and behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, which is a chief among the publicans, and he was rich. And he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the press, but God, he was little of stature. And as he ran before and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must abide in thy house. And he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. And when he saw it, they all murmured, saying that he was gone to be the guest of a man that is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor, and if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore it fourfold. And Jesus said unto him, This day is salvation come to this house, for as much as he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. Zacchaeus was not a particularly liked person. Matter of fact, nobody but other publicans had anything to do with him. The people wouldn't even speak to him. They didn't want to have any dealings with him whatsoever. And Jesus said, I'm going to dine at your house today. That in itself shows us the compassion that the Lord had. He knew the heart of Zacchaeus. He just knew he needed something. Zacchaeus needed to be satisfied. His religion had not brought that to him. I'm sure he went into the temple just like everybody else. He tried very hard. But he was little man. And when this crowd began to gather around Christ and they began to walk through Jericho, they looked and they thought, he thought, I can't see over this crowd. I'm just a little guy. He had to be pretty little to be little than the average Jew. The whole crowd, he couldn't watch them over. Women, men, or anybody. He could not see over them enough to be able to see Jesus. So he looked down the road, and right down the road there was a sycamore tree. Climbs up into the tree, and all his finery climbs up into that tree just to catch a glimpse of him. When Jesus came down, walking down through there, he's just gingerly walking by. He stopped. And as he stopped, he looked up. He said, Zacchaeus, come down. I must abide in my house today. This caused a great murmuring among the people. Who is this Jesus that he'd even dine with a publican? A tax collector, a chief among the tax collectors. They're a bunch of thieves. Literally taking money out of the hands of the people. Even overtaxing them, surcharging them to give. And Jericho was a very rich area. Very rich. Well, anyway, he was shocked. And he immediately came down. And said, up to half of my, well, no, he didn't say up to half. He says, half of my goods I give to the poor. There's an interesting story that happened in the 18th chapter. You may not catch the connection. But the rich young ruler, in the 18th chapter, he came to Jesus asking what he was to do to be saved. Jesus said, give all to God. So, then take the money and give it to the poor. Then you come follow me. It says, and the young man went away sorrowful because he had much to lose. His whole life ahead of him. But he wasn't willing. He lost his own soul. because he wasn't willing to give up the material things that he had. Why he got them, we don't know. Doesn't really make any difference. They were his. And he denied, I cannot give that up. And he lost his soul. He went away sorrowful. Well, there's a big difference between him and Nicodemus. And Nicodemus, just one chapter later, he's a rich man. All this was offered the same to him, except for one difference. He volunteered giving. Now, when someone volunteered, I love giving. Don't you just love the idea of giving your tithes and offerings? It doesn't stop with a tithe. It goes beyond a tithe to offerings. Now, how do you rob God in Malachi? It says, you have robbed God in tithes and offerings. So an individual looks at this. They have a certain resentment to giving to the Lord. But you know Zacchaeus was real, because he was willing to give half and then said, on top of that, if I've ever taken anything from any man, I'll replace it four times what it was worth. That amazes me, knowing how we are with money. Try your income to be cut in half. That's what happens when we retire. But seriously, as we think of this, Zacchaeus was considered a traitor among the Jews. They wanted nothing to do with him. They didn't open up and say, oh, here's Zacchaeus. Open up, let him go through. He wants to see Jesus. It was just the opposite. They had a choice. They wanted to block him out, get in his way. No way is he going to get in to see Jesus. Why, Jesus won't accept him anyway. And then Jesus does. What a surprise. So as we look at this, we're going to see Zacchaeus, make haste. I love these words. Make haste and come down. And probably before he finished the sentence, Zacchaeus was already coming down out of that tree. He said, make haste and come down, for today I must, love that word, must, abide at thine house. At thy house. Isn't that amazing? Think about it. Jesus called you by name. When you got saved, I don't care who you are, he called you by name. I know, because I experienced that as a 12-year-old boy. Preacher says, why are you coming? I said, why are you coming? He said, I says, I want to be saved. I felt God calling me. And I don't believe anyone gets saved without that kind of a call. I don't think it's a chance happening. It's a exact thing. Exact. When Jesus begins to deal with you, you know it. And I never, except one other time in my life, ever had the experience that I experienced that day. The feelings, the emotions. I only experienced it one day, and that was the day I surrendered my life and grew over to the Lord at a youth camp. I was the counselor. I had gone because nobody else would go. I wasn't first choice. I wasn't second choice. I was last choice. And I went. And that Thursday night, that God began to deal with me. And I surrendered to him. Lord, I'll do anything you want to be. One thing, Lorraine, if you ever speak with her and talk about this, she remembers the day that I gave my testimony. She reminds me every once in a while, I remember the day when you said, Lord, I'll do anything you want me to do. Never regretting any of it. Anyway, as we go through this, there are a number of scriptures that kind of imply this. We are looking for the security of salvation.
Many.
There's so many scriptures in the Word of God that lend to that. But some of them that I picked was Romans 12, 1 and 2. I beg of you, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present yourself a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto the Lord. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. God did a job of transformation. The word that is often used in the scriptures is metamorpho. It basically means, well, we get the word metamorphosis from it. And when we think about a metamorphosis, we're thinking of, for instance, larvae that turns into flies or other types of insects, or possibly a frog that's a tadpole when he's born, but then changes into a frog. He is a completely new creature. He's not the same as he was. The day he got saved, he changed. And when I was saved at a young age, 12, I wasn't mature yet. Sometimes I wonder how mature I am now. But anyway, I did not understand. I only knew that I needed to be saved. That's all I had understood. And God's grace saved me. Later in my life, when I was 22 years old, I had exactly the same experience that I had that day when Jesus dealt with me on salvation. When he called me, I had exactly the same experience. And I knew God was dealing with me. I was at camp. I called my wife that night. I had to go outside camp to do it. I went outside that night. I called her on the phone. She was scared to death because we had only been married a year. And I just took off. She was home all by herself in the apartment. And I called her and I said, honey, I just scripture my wife. Oh, God, to use any way he saw fit. And she said, oh, no. The next night, she was there. Seriously, she was there. And we sat down on the wall, not too far from the mess hall. And we sat there, just her and I alone, the two of us. And I said to her, honey, I don't know what this means. I just know God called me, and I surrendered to him. She says, Bob, you're not even the same person. You've changed so much. There's a transformation that takes place at a place of sanctification. Just as real, because most of us don't know about lordship when we get saved. Most people get saved between the age of 12 to 16. Most. That's the most likely to be saved. You don't know anything about worship. You don't understand about worship. God has to be with you. Now, adults, many times it's different. They understand, they have a clear mind, they're mature. And they know that when they receive Christ, they receive him as Lord as well as Savior. But we don't know that at a young age. At 22 years old, I was just a couple of weeks from being 23. I surrendered because God called me. I felt the drawing power of the Holy Spirit in my life. When we talk about sanctification is a real thought in the scriptures. You have salvation, and then you have sanctification. Two main themes of the scriptures. Matter of fact, many of the epistles, the general epistles, pastoral epistles, they're split. First half of it deals with maybe it's salvation. And then the second half deals with sanctification. You can't miss it when you read it in light of that. So you and I have to realize there's going to be a time in our life. It's not a chance happening. God deals with you, and we don't always say yes. How do I know that? Because today, particularly today, you don't know the difference between a lost person and a saved person by lifestyles. That's scary. Because in here, constantly over the scriptures, he talks about the transformation that takes place. It's an immediate change. It's not something that comes over time, although we do grow and mature in the Lord and change even more so over time. It's not that we ought to live that way. We are made to live that way. If you do not serve Christ in your life and you just go through the forms, you are most miserable. There is no joy like the joy of serving Christ. Nothing can compare to that. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. And probably would be better understood, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. What does that mean? That we ought to live good? No, we're made to live right. We're made to live righteously. Why is it that so many don't? It's easy to lose your place when you're up here. 2 Corinthians 6:17 says this, wherefore, come out from among them. What? The world. Come out from among them, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. It's a condition. You are transformed. You are made. You are regenerated into a new person when you get saved. And if you don't understand that, then I question, why not? Romans is the 7th chapter. I hear that so missed, the whole principle behind the 7th chapter of Romans. It talks about that which I would not do, I find myself doing, and then that which I would do, I don't find the strength to do it. What's he talking about? He's talking about someone trying to live a Christian life. He says, he even talks about the law and everything. He says, when the law came alive, I died. What's he mean by all that? You and I are regenerated by the power of the Holy Spirit, and we are to live because we're made to live for Christ. This is the cream of the crop. This is the best of our church as a general consensus. We should live so that the world looks at us and wonders what makes us tick. I think it's the Holy Spirit. They don't have it. We do. And we are to tick by the Holy Spirit's wooing us, calling us and dealing with us until we do what we should do. That's just the first page. See what I said? I cannot preach it, what I've got here. It's just so rich to deal with it. But I did want to get to one point. Well, four small points, so to speak. One is that it's a miracle. Salvation, we talk about miracles today. The greatest miracle is the transformation that happens in the life of a believer when he gets saved. Not later on, although sometimes it does take a little while, but he is made. He does not satisfy himself unless he lives for Christ. There's no joy outside of it, out of that side of that for a Christian. But I noticed one thing. Zacchaeus wasn't feeling particularly good that day. He wasn't looking for a good feeling as some do when they go to church. He met Jesus Christ face to face. And as he says, these are the things I'm willing to do in order to be acceptable before Christ. As a thief, he reached, symbolically, reached into his own purse strings and opened them up to the rest of the world. He gave it up. What do I have to? He wanted to honor Christ. Not because it wasn't to get saved. It wasn't about salvation. He had gotten saved, and now he was showing it by the releasing of his monetary values. Getting rid of them. I don't need them. I need Christ. And he began to live for Christ from the very moment there was a transformation in the life of Zacchaeus. The second thing I wanted to mention, that Jesus is not a respecter of persons. If you or I were to choose the salvation for Zacchaeus, we wouldn't think, well, how many of you sincerely ever believe that Hitler went to heaven? Well, from what we know, we're pretty sure of it. That's not a problem. But does that mean that Christ would not have saved him? He saved Paul, who is the same kind of man on a smaller scale. You and I have got to realize we are sincerely, through our security, saved through Christ's blood. That's the only difference between you and I and the rest of them. We're saved sinners, and they're lost sinners. And we should have pity on them, not anger and hatred. We should be trying to win them. Jesus went out of his way that day. He actually went out of his way to see Zacchaeus that night, or that day. It was probably around noontime. I'm going to show you in just a minute. The other thing was, he did not want to bring reproach on Christ. If Christ had turned to him and says the same thing he said to the rich young ruler, he was not going to bring a blotch upon this man, this Christ, this Messiah. And it was so important because that very week, Christ was to die for our sins. But as you go through there, and says, matter of fact, when I say a week, it was actually 6 days. That was a Friday afternoon, or maybe even earlier, say noontime. Jesus says, I must. He left Zacchaeus' house, which was north of the Dead Sea, went south about a 15-mile walk to get there by 6 o'clock Friday night. Now, you all that know anything about the Jews know what 6 o'clock means. That's when they got to be within the Sabbath day's journey to the temple, to Jerusalem, to go to the temple that day, the next day. He had to be that close in order that he could, the next morning, get up and go. And I know it was a Sabbath, because it says he went around in the house, the temple, and he looked around and left. Why? It was the Sabbath day. They were all worshiping. But what happened the very next day was he went into the temple and beat out the thieves, those who were money changers. This is the second time in his ministry he did that, once in the beginning and then once again at the end. He made a way to clean the house up. And there's a whole eighth day of that day, of that week, is actually told to us in the scriptures. All, every single day. I'd be remiss not to mention salvation, because it says in 2 Corinthians 6:2, "Behold, now is the accepted time. Now is the day, behold, now is the day of salvation." When is the day of salvation? The day God begins to deal with you. And he does. He picks the time. He picks the choice. Not everyone responds. Though I should say responds favorably. Some reject him. And may never again. If Zacchaeus had turned down Christ that day, 6 days later he died on the cross, Zacchaeus would probably have been left lost and would have split hell wide open. Do you realize that? Christ made a journey out of his way to go up to Jericho and then go back down to Jerusalem on the very last day he could make it. The rest of the week was there in Jerusalem. Zacchaeus may have lost any chance of being saved. There is a time when your path and Christ's path cross. And if you do not respond, now is the day. And you lose your salvation. He wants everybody to be saved. There's no exceptions. If only they would respond. With this, I was going to go into a song, but I'll save you the trouble. Why not come to him now? But for us who are saved, yeah, it's the second time. I believe there is a second time. You have a choice. It's not salvation I'm talking about. It's that second time that God deals with you about a sanctified, holy, glorifying life that you can honor God with. I believe he calls us sometime. It will seem like maybe a chance happening, another crossing of time. But God begins to deal with us over our salvation that is not fully complete. It's not fully complete anyway, is it? We're not going to have our glorified body until we go to heaven. That's when salvation is complete. But the first is salvation. The second is sanctification. I cry out, you don't know how many times I cry out with my heart, what's wrong? It's because God's people. Someone's asked the question, what's wrong with our nation today? Guess who we put it on? Us. We're not living godly. We're not living holy. You can't tell the difference between a lost person and a saved individual today. By walk, talk, dress, and you go right on down the list. It's not just one thing. It's the whole lifestyle. There's something wrong with a lifestyle that's not glorifying Christ, and you say you're saved. They go together. These are like pieces of a puzzle that fit together. Just remember this, a closing thought. God is sovereign. He wishes that every man would be saved. But he will not use his sovereignty and force you to be saved. He will not use his sovereignty to make you live the way you want to live. He gives you the Holy Spirit to help you manifest his power within you in order to woo you into living a life that the world will look at and be thrilled, desirous of, wish they had it. And then they'll come to us and ask us, what must I do to be saved? Some will walk away from it. Others will receive it. That's within their will. God will not make them do something they don't want to do. Why don't we dedicate ourselves to God? It's the most thrilling experience this side of salvation. I don't understand it. Your whole being belongs to Him. If He's to be Lord, He can't be Lord only on Sundays. He can't be Lord on a few days of the week when you have your Bible studies or whatever. He has to be Lord every single day of your life, or He's not Lord at all. It's not yours. Your life, your body belongs to Him. You're bought with a price. The precious blood of Christ. Strive for it. Seek it. And I guarantee you, you'll find a life that just is so full. What God calls you to do, you do. That's all. That's all He wants. He says, you be Lord. All you have to do is do what I want you to do. That would change, would be a manifestation, a transformation of our churches as well. Individuals, yeah. But you see, churches made up of individuals. And if they're not doing it, who is? Who's honoring God? Why is our country in a mess when it was going the right way for 200, over 200 years? Or close to 200 years anyway. How do we know? The only way is if we try it God's way. Honor Him by your life. It belongs to Him. Let's ask God's blessings. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we do thank You for the privilege to be able to speak and to teach these principles. We realize that we are saved and that we are secure through Christ. But we don't always have all this God offers us. And only because of our own selfishness. Help us to give up. Be willing to give not just our tithes and offerings, but our whole being over to Christ that He can use it for His honor and for His glory. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.